Brittany Robbins, executive editor of entrepreneur.com, and I'm pleased to welcome you to Women Who Inspire Us, a series spotlighting some incredible women entrepreneurs in honor of International Women's Day. Over the next little while, you'll hear their inspiring stories, as well as their secrets to success, and even some practical advice that you can apply to your own business ventures. First up, we have Jane Poynter, one of the first women to break into the space exploration field. She was technical advisor to Elon Musk prior to SpaceX's launch, and has co-founded luxury space flight experience company, Space Perspective, which is, quote unquote, redefining space tourism and going head to head with the billionaire Rocketman's Club. With that, I hope you enjoy my conversation with Jane. Jane, thank you so much for being with us today.
It is absolutely my pleasure, and what a day.
How did you get started down this road of science, sustainability, and exploration?
Yeah, I was really lucky. I got involved in this project called Biosphere 2. I was on the design team, and then I lived inside it for 2 years and 20 minutes, but who's counting? And, you know, it was just the most amazing experience. So Biosphere 2 is an entirely sealed prototype space base for understanding planet Earth, but also a laboratory to understand planet Earth, right? So, I mean, it was just the most profound experience to be involved in that. And that really set me off on this path for space exploration, you know, frankly, wanting to go to space myself one day. It was exactly the kind of experience that I would wish on every young 20-something, because it changed my life.
So tell me a little bit more about the experience of Biosphere 2. What were some of the kind of scientific and personal challenges that you faced living in this hermetically sealed environment for 2 years and 20 minutes?
It was really an audacious project to be the very first time humans had ever built an artificial biosphere. So you can imagine it was a really challenging project, but extremely exciting to be a part of. You know, we had amazing scientists from around the world involved in this. You know, at a personal level, when I went inside Biosphere 2, the thing that was so surprising was the experience of being completely embedded in my biosphere, right? So I knew moment to moment that the plants around me were giving me my oxygen to breathe, that the CO2 that I was exhaling was growing the food that I was eating. And we were eating so many sweet potatoes that we were turning orange. So we were becoming visibly part sweet potato. I could see the edges of my world. I knew that everything we had in there was all we had. So that was a very profound experience, which of course is completely extendable to the way we think about a planetary biosphere, Biosphere 1.
Talk to me a little bit about Space Perspective now. How did this kind of originate? I know you're kind of setting yourself apart from the billionaire Rocket Men's Club. I would love to know how Space Perspective is different than all of the other tourism companies.
So Space Perspective does go all the way back to my time in Biosphere 2. You know, ever since then, I have wanted to take as many people as possible to space. And these space balloons are just so perfect for being able to give people this extraordinary experience of seeing Earth in space and that whole new perspective that comes along with that. So we really wanted to have a flight that was gentle and calm so that when you're up there, you can really absorb it. And that's what the space balloon does. So it goes to space at 12 miles an hour. The entire flight is this smooth flight that is 2 hours up. You're 2 hours at the top looking out at the Earth and 2 hours back down. And by the way, you're going to see sunrise. So get ready to get up early. But it is going to be the most insane sunrise. I've seen videos of this, and it's truly breathtaking. Unlike when you're on the International Space Station, if you've seen those, right, you do see the sun in the blackness of sky. But there, because it's going around the Earth so fast, the sun is up and then the sun is down. Whereas with us, it's a full sunrise that you are seeing with all of the colors, and then you see the sun in the blackness of the sky is going to be just completely crazy. So it's this very gentle and accessible way of going to space. It's also a zero emission spacecraft, and we operate the company as a carbon neutral company. So, you know, we really are embracing to take as many people as possible. We're also working with scientists and artists and all kinds of other people to get involved in this as well. So, yeah, we truly want to take as many people as possible and have this experience of seeing Earth in space at the core of that experience.
So you actually served as a technical advisor to Elon Musk back in the day, right, before he founded SpaceX. Can you talk a little bit about that experience?
Yeah, that was really fun. Yeah, that was a long time ago. That was before Elon started SpaceX. So yeah, that was actually at Paragon.
Oh, wow.
So the very first thing we did with him was we were building a small greenhouse to send plants to Mars.
Mm-hmm.
He went off to Russia to go get the rocket to fly our greenhouse to Mars, and on the way back decided he was going to start SpaceX, which was all very exciting. And so our team actually helped him with some of his very first commercial proposal writing, kind of did a whole architecture of the rocket and the proposal writing with NASA for them to be in that whole first commercial space flight group cohort of companies. What's really critically important to understand about sort of what's been happening in space flight is at the time, you know, this whole notion of companies doing things that until then only governments were thought of as being capable of doing was really not taken that seriously. And SpaceX was the poster child that showed the industry, well, yes, we can. And that has been deeply and profoundly affected the trajectory, I believe, of space and commercial spaceflight, and has certainly been an inspiration to us here at Space Perspective.
So today is International Women's Day. Is there one woman that comes to mind who has been an inspiration to you throughout your career?
Yeah, Jane Goodall.
That's a good one.
My countrywoman, right? I mean, so Jane Goodall, she was amazing. I mean, she did things that, you know, men, you know, didn't think women were supposed to do when she went out to Africa. And then not only did she just go, she broke the entire paradigm of how we think about chimpanzees and other primates. You know, they weren't supposed to have cultures and emotions like us. And she was like, but wait a minute. Yes, they do. So she was able to really reimagine the science. And that was incredibly inspiring to me and always has been and always will be.
So now you have a chance to be an inspiration to a lot of other women and women entrepreneurs. So I would love to know, what has been the secret to your longstanding success that could be applicable to other women entrepreneurs and innovators?
I have banished the word impossible from my vocabulary. You know, Peter Diamandis, who is a good friend, has this great saying: if you think something is impossible, it is for you. Another of my favorite sayings is by Theodore Roosevelt, which is, keep your eyes on the stars and your feet on the ground.
I love that.
I love that because it's such inspiration, and it's think big, it's do big, it's reach for the stars, but really keep grounded in your own reality. And your own reality is that you can be so much more than you ever imagined you could be.
Thank you so much for being with us today, and happy International Women's Day.
Thank you.
Thanks to Jane Poynter for sharing her insights with us. And check out entrepreneur.com for more coverage of inspiring women entrepreneurs in honor of International Women's Day.
Next up, we have Deepa Purushothaman, an author and entrepreneur who left the corporate world after more than 20 years to focus on diversity and inclusion efforts for women of color. She's the author of the newly released book, The First, The Few, The Only, How Women of Color Redefine Power in Corporate America, and the co-founder of Information, a community created for women of color by women of color. Deepa, let's chat. You spent most of your career at Deloitte. What initially drew you to the corporate world?
Yeah, it's not a magic big answer. It was as simple as, like, my background was in policy. I went to the Kennedy School. I also did a degree from London School of Economics, so they weren't MBAs. And so I thought, after working in politics prior to grad school, that I needed to have private sector experience to be qualified to go work, you know, in the public sector. And so I thought, I'm going to go to Deloitte for a year or two. Had a great reputation for women, and it seemed like a really great place to go start my career, develop my career. And I ended up there for more than 20 years, not the 1 year I thought I was going to be there. So,
And when you made partner, you were the first Indian American woman partner at Deloitte, and you were also one of the youngest people to be made partner ever. What was the biggest challenge you faced in reaching that goal, and how did you overcome it?
I think for me, it was a lot of feeling if I belonged, and less to do with what anything the company did and more of my own insecurities. I think when you don't see a role model that looks like you coming before you, you sometimes question, do you belong? What does that look like? And I had to find my own way in a lot of situations, right? Everything from what I dressed like to how I presented myself to how I gave feedback to even kind of how I asked for what I wanted. Those weren't models that had been shown to me, and they weren't examples that I had seen often. And so there was a little bit of trying to always figure it out because I didn't exactly see myself, you know, represented before me. And that's not just a lawyer, right? That's in corporate America in general, that's on television, that's everywhere. And so I think when you don't see yourself and, you know, you're in institutions that kind of tell you that leadership doesn't look like you, you have to like do your own work to rewrite your messages that you belong and, you know, that you can make it. And so I did a lot of that on my own.
And I know that you spent 22 years at Deloitte. You were there, you made partner, you headed up a few different areas. Then you left about 2 years ago to write a book and start your own business.
Yes.
So what convinced you to finally take that leap and leave your safe corporate job?
So two things. One is it was not easy to leave. And so I want to start with that. I think as a woman of color and one of the first, I really felt responsible sitting in the seat. It took me almost 3 years between knowing I wanted to leave and to actually leave. And I felt like people were going to look at me and say she couldn't hack it, or, you know, we put her in this role. What does that mean for others that look like her or have her similar experiences? And so I felt really responsible. And so one of the things I started to do was to gather women of color. It started one-on-one because I just wanted to know, like, what are other places that where do women go? Like, I was very knee deep in having conversations about intersectionality at that time and really feeling like there was more work to be done in this space. And you have to remember, this was a number of years ago. So this wasn't like now where it's now a topic we talk about. And so I started gathering those women of color one-on-one. Over the course of the next few months, that ended up becoming about a dozen dinners across the country that I did with my now business partner, who was then my coach. And we would get in these rooms and we were just networking. We were just meeting these women of color. I didn't know a lot of them. They were cold, like messages over LinkedIn. I'm going to be in New York. Do you want to grab dinner? That sort of thing. And it would grow from there. And we would get in these rooms and I thought, spend an hour or two together. 6, 7, 8 hours later, literally no exaggeration, at 2 or 3 in the morning, we were still in the spaces sharing stories of what it was like to navigate as a first few and only. And so I think there was such shared experience from that. And there was such a need coming out of that conversation for me to want to create safe space for women of color, for me to want to write this book and to talk about what it's like when you feel alone. Because most of the women of color I've met have had to navigate spaces and they feel the weight of being alone in those spaces, but they also don't know how to talk about it. We're not encouraged to talk about it. And there's a sense that in order to thrive and rise, that you have to just kind of go it alone. And that's part of what I'm trying to change, because that's how I freed myself.
So today is International Women's Day, and I'd like to ask you, what is the best advice any woman has ever given you?
The best advice I think any woman has ever given me is to know my worth, right? To, you know, and people have said that all the time, but I don't know that I knew what that meant. You know, I kind of now tell women, I want them to know that they're powerful and that they have power and they can exercise power and that we can ask for what we want in any and all situations. We may not get it. But it's okay to ask for it.
So what do you think has been one of the secrets to your success that could be applicable to other women in the corporate world or women of color who are thinking about starting a business or taking a leap and leaving a job?
I think I've always found a way to do me, you know, and I'm not saying that's easy in all contexts or any context. It's hard. You know, there's a lot of pressure to not do you and to not ask questions and not to show up. I think I did it early on when I was less tenured in my career because I didn't think I was going to be there forever. There was a freedom that came with knowing like I wasn't an MBA and I wasn't going to be in corporate ever that let me say what I wanted to say. And so my advice to women, because I met with so many senior women as I was, you know, doing interviews for the book, so many of them would get to the seat and then regret their choices or feel like they'd given up too much of themselves or felt even more pressure once they were in the seat to conform and toe the line. I think we have to find ways to really be ourselves and use our voice earlier because it's not something that you can say will come later. Like later doesn't come. So find ways to understand what your boundaries are. I'm not asking you to, you know, push on everything, but know what matters to you. And on those things, do not compromise.
That's great advice. Well, thank you so much for joining us today. Best of luck with the rest of the book launch. I am so excited to read it all the way through.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thanks so much for joining us today. Deepa's book is on sale now. And for more inspiring stories about women entrepreneurs, visit entrepreneur.com.
Hi, I'm Marc Randolph, co-founder of Netflix and six other companies. Over the years, I've heard that will never work thousands of times, but I've learned there are things we all can do to increase the chances that they will. So join me for That Will Never Work.
Hey everyone, today's episode is a special one. We are filming live and in person from the television production studios at High Point University in High Point, North Carolina. We're doing a special student edition where I'm speaking with student entrepreneurs from High Point's entrepreneurship program. I'm talking to Erin Morrow, who's a sophomore here, who's invented a kind of interesting product called the Finger Flyer. It's a small palm-sized drone. And I think Erin does have some questions about where does this go from here?
Erin, welcome to That Will Never Work.
Thank you.
So excited to actually hear what you're up to. And more importantly, I want to see this thing in action.
Oh yeah? I'd love to show you.
So tell me about it. What is this thing? Where did the idea come from?
So this is a quadcopter drone and it doesn't use any controllers. It's all based on sensors, active and passive. So we marketed this as an educational tool, actually, as well as to sell just B2C.
We? Is there more than one?
Yes, there is. My partner, Jacob, he is an engineer at Georgia Tech, and he now works at Boeing.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
So this is developed by a Boeing engineer.
Yes, it is. He had been working on the technology for quite some time, and then I came up with the idea to make an educational tool. So now we sell it unassembled, and we sell it to school districts across the country alongside our labs.
And what made you come up with the idea to have it be an educational tool rather than a toy?
So I'm an education major and I'm always working with students. I tutor as well. And I've just seen like all the learning styles that students have and how unique it is to each student. And one day I was just going along with my morning routine and it kind of dawned on me how cool this drone technology would be for students learning about STEM, because there is a really big push for STEM right now.
Right. So playing with a drone will let kids get better grades in their engineering and math classes, right?
Pretty much, yeah.
I love that idea. So listen, before we actually dig into the entrepreneurial side of this, why don't you at least show me this thing so I have a better idea of what it is, what it does, and
I would love to.
Why it's so amazing. All right, so there it is.
So once the lights stop blinking on the drone, it's very simple. All you have to do is toss it up. And to turn it off, you just flip it upside down.
Wow, pretty cool. Let me try.
Don't toss it too high. And that's how you stop it.
Wow.
And yeah, there are sensors all along the side, so I could easily just pass it to you. Do you want me to try?
Sure, let's try that. This drone is a... Oh, we just passed it back and forth without touching it. Mm-hmm. So fantastic, Erin. Really cool.
Yeah.
So tell me, what does this teach kids?
It teaches students all about underlying physics, aerodynamics, all the STEM topics. We made sure that it was really fun and engaging. We wanted to make sure students were doing math without even realizing they were doing math. So there's a lot of calculations about LiPo batteries and why we use this battery and comparing them to like AA batteries or AAA batteries. And there's a lot of calculations that go along with it. It's a hard decision of why it's the best battery, but we made sure students didn't even realize they were doing math as they were following along with our labs.
Well, I really love what you're doing.
Thank you.
And what's kind of interesting is this is now a product kind of looking for the right way to sell it rather than someone who's identified this hole and trying to figure out what to sell.
Yeah.
So you're in a good position.
Thank you.
Well, anyway, I do wish you huge amounts of luck with this. Hope it, if you'll pardon the expression, takes off.
Thank you.
And let's check in sometime in the future.
Yeah,
and
love
let me
to.
Know let me know what worked.
All right. Thank you so much for meeting with me today. This was great.
My pleasure, Erin. Good luck.
Thank you.
Next up, we have Christine Day, an executive with 30 years of experience scaling global retail brands. She worked her way up the corporate ladder at Starbucks, eventually heading up the company's Asia Pacific division. Then from 2008 to 2013, she served as CEO of athletic apparel brand Lululemon. Now she's teamed up with celebrity power couple Ciara and Russell Wilson to bring you the House of LRNC, a company with a mission to democratize retail and redefine the way the fashion industry works. So you see, she has some experience when it comes to running a successful business. And without further ado, here's Christine.
All right.
Christine, thank you so much for being with us today.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I'm happy to be here.
So can you tell us how the House of LRNC got started, what the mission of the company is, and how did you connect with Russell and Ciara?
Well, I'll start with the last one first. So I connected with Russell and Ciara through a mutual friend. Well, I was actually good friends with Derek Jeter, and Russell wanted to meet Derek Jeter. So a mutual friend asked if I could introduce them when Derek came to play his last game in Seattle. So so I arranged for Russell to come to the stadium and get a VIP tour behind the scenes and meet Derek. And I bought the tickets. And then what was funny about it was I got a call from the Mariners and they said, "Is that the Russell Wilson?" I said, "Yes." And they go, "You can't sit in those seats." I go, "What do you mean?" And he goes, "It'll disrupt the whole crowd. Nobody will pay attention because we got seats behind home base." So they made me buy a suite. So I had to host Russell in the suite. And so then we invited a whole bunch of people and we got to know each other then. And then he was an ambassador at my food company, and our friendship and kind of my mentorship, I think, of him just grew over that time. He came to me for a lot of questions. And then ultimately I met Sarah as well through him. And that's how we got to know each other. And then he asked for help with a fashion brand that he had started for men, Good Man Brand. And over the course of that, he asked if I would also help develop a line for Ciara, and then would I run the company? And so one thing led to another. And my condition for yes was that I didn't feel like the world needed just another clothing company. So I said, look, I'll do this. If we create sustainable fashion, we set it up as a public benefit corp, and we strive to become a B Corp. So that we measure everything we do through a third party. And they said, absolutely, we're all about impact and raising the bar, leveling up, as Ciara would say. And so that's how we formed the House of Love, Respect, and Care.
As an executive with decades of experience in a male-dominated field, I imagine that there have often been times when you may be the only woman in the room where decisions are being made. So can you talk a little bit about that experience, and specifically if you ever had a moment where you may have felt a little underestimated and how you overcame that?
Oh God, constantly. But you know, underestimate me at your own peril is what my mother would have told me. But you know, it's I think that ability to be patient and be firm and learning to get my elbows up when I needed to, and how to handle situations. And you know, I learned to do things like in, you know, a meeting, if I wasn't being heard or if other people were, you know, then saying what I was saying and then being heard, jumping back in and saying, you know, thanks, Bob, for, you know, for echoing my idea. I'd like to build on that and say the following. So you learn to handle those situations. Or, you know, honestly, a couple pieces of advice that people gave me was, if you're talking and defending a lot, you have to shift into asking questions and making other people defend their position, as opposed to staying and defending yours. So that's a power play. So I learned, you know, pretty quickly, if somebody was criticizing me or whatever, I'd make them explain their position as opposed to defending my position. And so just those subtle, you know, power moves are really important. But the other thing I think was, I really strove to build good relationships with the people that I worked with, so that there was trust. And it wasn't always possible. And then my biggest advice is, if that person isn't working for you like you're working for them, get out. You know, so don't stay and suffer. I think women stay and suffer way too much. And the other thing I really learned, and there were some moments, like, a, you know, kind of a funny story about it, was I was working in the store development department at Starbucks, and my boss changed his meetings to 7:30 in the morning. And I had a 45-minute commute. I had two kids to get out the door in the morning because my husband was at work at Boeing at 6:30 in the morning. And I was killing myself for about 6 months. And then I went into his office and I was like, you know, I'm going to quit if, you know, blah, 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 blah. And he goes, why didn't you just ask to change the moving back, or change the meeting back? You're a valuable player. I had suffered for 6 months yelling at my kids in the morning, everything else, because I didn't speak up for myself. So that was a really valuable lesson, to speak into what I want or what I need versus a complaint. And that, I think, shifted, just, you know, powerfully saying what I needed versus being in complaint or letting myself suffer or whatever, and then making powerful choices about taking responsibility for whatever the answer was. And that came from understanding, you know, the confidence of my worth and my contribution. And so I think just all those kind of subtle things over time, that you learn how to handle the different dynamics, but with trust and positivity, and not complaint.
I think there might be an advice book in your future. that really resonated with me. I would love to know, kind of, all this knowledge that you have now, what advice would you give to your younger self?
That you switchbacks are fine. You don't always have to go straight up the cliff. being very competitive, I always took on like the hardest assignments, and, you know, sometimes even before I was ready, and I just muscled through. You know, sometimes I think at great like personal cost to like myself. Because sometimes you have to work harder at things because you don't know what you're doing, right? You know, so once you've built up the skills, it's more effortless. And so always throwing yourself into the deep end of the pool or up the highest cliff, you know, it's like I look at like a kind of, there was a woman who was a peer of mine, and she mastered the switchback approach. So she always looked good everywhere. She went, like, I was a lot messier going up, straight up. But you know what? I think the resilience and persistence and tenacity that I, you know, had to do to stick with things, but I definitely could have done a few more eddies and moved, you know, laterally, or, you know, taken my time a little bit, been more patient, and still had the same outcome. So I think, don't be in such a hurry. Everything doesn't have to be hard all the time.
Christine, thank you so much for taking the time today, and happy International Women's Day.
Thank you. Happy International Women's Day to you as well. Thanks for having me.
Well, that was another fantastic chat with the woman who inspires us. And now moving on to our next guest.
Next, we're speaking with Jing Gao, a chef, culinary expert, and the founder of premium Chinese food company Fly by Jing. The company started as an underground supper club, and she launched it on Kickstarter in 2018. Since then, Fly by Jing has expanded into new product lines and become a pantry staple for chefs across America. Jing, let's chat. Jing, thanks so much for being here with us today. So tell me about your passion for food. How old were you when you started cooking, and who taught you?
So growing up, we were moving a lot in countries where you couldn't really find, you know, Chinese ingredients. And so my mom, you know, in a way kind of inspired me with how she adapted to cooking in the countries that we were in, using the limited resources and ingredients that we had. And have to admit, like I wasn't, you know, really into food in a particular way until I really moved to China in my 20s. That was where, you know, I think my palate was really awakened by all of these incredible Chinese flavors, regional flavors that I hadn't really been exposed to because I'd grown up in the West. And it, you know, the more I tried, the more I learned about this incredible 5,000 year heritage and the complexity of this cuisine. And, you know, the more I wanted to share it.
And you crowdfunded on Kickstarter to get started and to make the product. So what went into that decision and how was that experience overall?
Yeah, so I crowdfunded on Kickstarter because I had no capital to, you know, to do this. And I went to some co-packers. They were telling me, you know, a minimum run might cost like $30,000 to $50,000 US. And, you know, I didn't have that upfront capital, but I had heard of, you know, a lot of friends who have had success with Kickstarter campaigns where, you know, it's not like some other platforms where it is kind of more of a donation. Kickstarter is prepayment for products. So it's an exchange for product and services. It is just that the audience is more, you know, more forgiving of the fact that this is a first-time entrepreneur most of the time. And, you know, that the journey to entrepreneurship is rocky and a lot of things can come up. So, you know, that kind of gives you that leeway of being able to deliver your products with some delays if they do happen, which always happens when you're a first-time entrepreneur. So, you know, so for those reasons, I decided to launch on Kickstarter first and also, you know, test kind of the US market and see the appetite for what I was doing.
So the COVID-19 pandemic did two things for your brand. Everyone was cooking at home, so products like yours were more popular than ever. But xenophobia and racism towards Chinese and Chinese American companies was rampant and still is. So how did you handle that as a leader with your team?
That's a great question. Yeah, I mean, it was the last couple of years have been, you know, filled with ups and downs. You know, with COVID hitting, there was a period of, you know, uncertainty, volatility, fear, which was then followed by kind of the, you know, biggest boom for our business that we've ever experienced. We ended up 10xing our business in 2020 and really kind of entering into the mainstream consciousness. But at the same time, you know, the amount of, you know, trolls and kind of vitriol that we receive online, which has always been present, amplified, right? People were saying that they want nothing to do with Chinese food. You know, I mean, to a lot of very, you know, from subtle to very blatantly racist comments and stuff. I think what's important for us to remember is that our growth and, you know, which has not stopped in the midst of all of this, it has grown further. And it just really speaks to kind of the universality of flavor and flavor bringing people together. And that is kind of a testament to our work.
And what do you think has been one of the secrets of your success that could be applicable to other women founders who are maybe thinking about starting a business?
I think, you know, find your product market fit first. In my case, I was running this underground supper club, and, you know, also it wasn't planned. This whole journey was very organic, one step in front of the other. And, you know, looking back, you can see the through line, but at the time, sometimes you can't. But what I didn't realize at the time was when I was cooking all these dinners, that was my consumer research, right? People were instantly, I could see their feedback on the flavors. And so by the time that I was launching the product, I already knew what products that I was gonna launch, which ones were resonating with people. And, you know, I knew that if we did a Kickstarter, if we told the story right, that it was going to work out, right? I think that's really the most important is finding your product market fit. And sometimes that is on a small scale. Sometimes, you know, you don't need a ton of resources to do that.
That's great advice. So those are all the questions that I have. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me.
For more stories about inspiring women entrepreneurs, visit entrepreneur.com.
Today, we're actually filming live and in person here at High Point University in High Point, North Carolina. I'm here in their high-end production studio speaking with student entrepreneurs for a special student edition of That Will Never Work. Today, I'm speaking with Ivana Karanchi, who is a graduate student in pharmacy, who's invented a product called the Flasky. I think she has some questions about where to take this product and perhaps what her next steps are as an entrepreneur. Well, let's meet Ivana now. Good morning, Ivana.
Hi, nice to see you.
It's great to have you on That Will Never Work. I'm really excited to hear what you're working on. So I'd love to hear a little bit about your progress. What is Flasky? And then maybe we could get to what you want to talk about.
Well, first, Mark, thank you for having me. I really appreciate this. So Flasky is a device. I've been for the past 4 years a lab researcher here at High Point University. And they always give the lab researchers the tasks nobody wants to do. But when we make medications and drugs, we make them in these very specific bottles called round bottom flasks. So they're shaped like a light bulb and they have a small opening and they have a big volume flask at the bottom.
So I got to ask you a question. So is that an Erlenmeyer flask or is that something different?
Totally different.
All I know from my chemistry class back in high school. There's a round one and then there's the triangular one, right?
Yes.
Okay, we're talking about the round one.
The round one. Okay. Correct. Yeah. So with this round one, when we use it, we always have this flashback of all the whatever components we put into it come right back up on the walls of the flask. And so this always happens 100% of the time. Everyone knows it's gonna happen. And so we have a tool to use to scrape it out. So we use something shaped like a pencil to go right into the flask and scrape the contents out. But the tool is very ineffective. What it is it's a straight piece going into a circular object. And so it doesn't work really well. We always have to conform it, bend it. And I just spent so many hours trying to figure out what can I do to solve this problem, to scrape things out of this flask much faster.
I got to back up for a second. Yeah. So this seems to be the problem of the flask, not the cleaning tool. Is the flask, and for those people who are watching it on video, and you can see the little flasks, I assume these are what you're talking
about. Yes, absolutely.
But is that design where it's around with a narrow neck designed to keep things from splashing out? Is that why they do it like that?
Yeah, so it's actually
as opposed to doing it in a beaker, you see? I'm paying attention.
So it's actually designed this way because it's part of a couple of another device. So it's like the other half of a bigger device called a rotary evaporator. I know.
Okay, we're going down a path I can tell already is in trouble.
Yeah, so one can't be without the other. Okay. So it kind of is stuck to this round-shaped flask.
All right, so you're sitting here struggling, trying to clean out a round device with a linear little pencil-like thing.
Absolutely.
And what happens? You're getting frustrated, it's not working?
Yeah, absolutely. It's taking 20 minutes to do a task that, if we had a better device to clean it, could take maybe 5 minutes,
okay,
2 minutes.
And then inspiration strikes?
Yeah, somewhat like that. I started realizing, hey, let me go online, figure out what I can do about this, and tell my lab instructor, like, maybe we can find a new device. But I couldn't find anything out there. So I think a lot of trial runs hit before inspiration hit. But yep, I tested everything. I was like, oh, okay, I know what I need. I need something that has multiple pieces that can conform and bend like an elbow joint, and we'll be all set.
So Flasky is born.
Yes.
You want to show me, you have one here?
Absolutely. So like I was saying—
Show me the old one first, or is
Yeah, mm-hmm, absolutely. So this is what we currently use, the floss. And this is what the floss looks like, empty.
So you got a picture, it's kind of like one of those little dental tools,
yes,
that are all lined up in the tray next to you when you're having a dentist appointment. It's like a stick with a little scraper at the end, mm-hmm, of it.
Okay. Yep, and I actually have two, so if you want to hold one.
Oh, look at this, okay. Do I have any safety glasses or a lead apron or anything like that to do this?
Hopefully we'll both be fine.
This is ridiculous. This is the state of the art for cleaning out that little thing?
Absolutely, and you see how full it is.
Oh my God, that's a mess.
Yeah, so you can go ahead and stick it right down in there.
No, I can't, this is crazy. No way.
Yeah, and okay, so this is what
I see the idea. Am I gonna like
poison myself with this stuff. I'm not gonna touch it.
But yes, so okay. Typically we use this, and this is what we do. We'll have it bent on one side, and we'll just kind of tilt it in and be like, okay, we're gonna get that bottom 60% scraped off just like that. Okay. And we take our time.
I can see how this sucks already. Okay.
Yeah, but what I decided to do was to invent a hook shape. This is like Captain Hook's pirate hook.
I see, it's brilliant.
Yeah, that snakes into the flask and actually does a one swipe clean. So you just snake it in, and to clean the top half of the flask.
Oh, look at that.
You get it all cleared out without actually having to bend anything with those stainless steel spatulas. And then to get the bottom half of the flask, you just push it down a little bit more.
All right, I get the idea.
Yeah.
Pretty cool. I'm self-evidently better.
So people complain about this problem all the time, but they're conditioned to overlook their problems because they know that the end goal is patient care or delivering medications. What would you say to introducing solutions like this?
You have got to find the person who cares. And that's the key piece of this, is you've got to find the person who actually cares about this. And there is someone for whom their job performance is being measured on what their yield is, who is the person who's supervising all the lab techs, and are being measured on the fact that, hey, I've been able to do the same amount of work with one fewer person. You've got to identify that person, and that person will resonate with them. Selling it on peace and love feels good, but usually isn't sufficient to get someone to crack open their wallet.
Thank you.
Okay, Ivana. So I'm going to send you off with that advice. You have some homework now.
Sounds good.
I know you have all kinds of extra time, but it's going to require getting out of your lab gear and putting on your sales suit and seeing if you can sell these in some volume. In addition to figuring out whether the product is right, you're going to learn whether the pricing is right. You're going to learn who the right target customer is. And those are all things I would love you to know before you spend $10,000 on a mold.
Thank you so much, Marc. I appreciate that.
My pleasure. Well, good luck. And when I'm back, hopefully doing this again on campus soon, I will check in with you, and I'm really curious to hear how it went.
Thank you.
Hi, and happy International Women's Day. We are here with Nicole Mendelson, who is the global head of Meta, formerly Facebook's advertising business. And she's going to tell us a bit about her career in tech and how she got to where she is today in honor of International Women's Day. So I think just to start, kind of tell me a bit about your role as your global head of Meta's advertising business. So how did you get here? Is this something you kind of always wanted to do? Kind of what steps did you take to get to where you are?
Yeah, so, well, I definitely couldn't have always have imagined doing a role like this, because when I started out in my career 30 years ago, the internet didn't even exist. Yes, I am that old. I spent over 20 years in the advertising industry, and I was always really curious to learn about what the new things were and what was especially happening as digital began to progress, what was happening more and more there. And at one point, I was then the head of the ad industry in the UK, the president of the Institute of Practitioners in Advertising. And I'd started to form early links with the likes of Facebook, as was then. And when they were looking for a new head of EMEA, Europe, Middle East, and Africa, they came and approached me. And that was almost 9 years ago now. So that's kind of a quick how I got to be what I'm doing today.
That's amazing. And I know that Meta is very big on supporting women, you know, throughout your careers and just through everything that you guys do. So specifically for International Women's Day, what kind of steps is the company taking? What kind of initiatives are you guys running this year?
Yeah, we're doing a lot of things. And, you know, it starts at the top from Marc, who has set out from a company perspective, first off, that he wants the whole company by 2024. It was a 5-year goal that he set. Mm-hmm. To be 50% of underrepresented people making up our own workforce. And we run a number of programs internally to bring on minorities, and including women, into more senior positions and training them for leadership. So you really feel it working at Meta, how important this is. And then that spills over into the work and the commitments that we make externally as well. So I'm very proud of the fact that back in 2016, I launched a program called She Means Business. In the UK, you can hear from my accent, I'm a Brit. And this was a program to really listen to, you know, what women out there were telling us, women that wanted to set up a business, perhaps didn't know how. And to date now, we have actually trained over 1.5 million women on digital skills. So that's something that's very exciting, the fact that that's out there. And there's a whole hub now, the She Means Business Hub, where you can go, you can see amazing stories of women that have set up their businesses just with a mobile phone. And, you know, in some instances built very, very large scale businesses. The thing that we're doing differently this year is we're constantly talking to women about what is it they need to help them with their business. And a constant thing that we're hearing is that a lot of women lack the financial literacy to actually go about setting up their business. So for this year, we're creating a new training program that's just about that, that can give women access to really understand, you know, what are the financial basics? What do you need to understand when setting up a business? Because we know that that can often be a really big barrier to women, and that's a barrier we want to get rid of.
Definitely. And, you know, I know that a part of these programs is women supporting women and women helping other women. You know, in your career, is there one woman you can think of that either mentored you or gave you great advice? Or, you know, what was one piece of advice you got from someone, another woman in the industry that kind of helped her?
Yeah, and it's such an important question, isn't it? And it also speaks to the importance of relatable role models as well. And I think everybody needs that. Not just the people that we look up to up here, but actually having somebody that's maybe in a similar position to you in your career. I think that's important. And I've been very blessed from early doors. You know, my mum and my grandma both worked, so I was always picking up things from them. Mm-hmm. There's a couple of things. I'll give two if I'm allowed. I know you asked one.
Oh, definitely, yes.
One is about speaking up. I think it's incredibly important. Mm-hmm. Often women have these whole conversations in their head, which are quite exhausting, where they're role playing out. What if I say something? Will they think I'm stupid? What are people going to think? And then somebody else, you know, usually says what you were going to say. I used to sit early in my career like that. So that's one, speak up. You know, that's really important. You're in the room because people want to hear from you. And the second one is a practical one. And it came from an amazing lady called Stevie Spring, who I was very fortunate is a dear friend now, but a very important mentor to me earlier in my career. And she said to me, you know, Nicola, when it all sometimes gets a little bit too much and you can feel those tears welling, she said, whistle, just whistle. And I promise you, you cannot cry and whistle. And you know what? She is right. So if it ever happens, give a whistle. You might look a little silly whistling, but it's better than the, you know, the makeup rolling in it.
Exactly.
She knows, et cetera. You can't cry and whistle.
That's amazing. I love that one. That kind of segues into my next question, because I was going to ask you what one of your secrets to success is, but maybe it would be whistling. But what is kind of like, if someone says to you, know, like, what's your secret sauce? What's the one thing that you make sure you do every day, you know, to kind of help to get you where you are? Do you know, is there anything in particular you can think of?
I guess a practical thing that I have is that I'm a great believer in vision writing. So I don't know if you know about this, but vision writing is that you set out and you write down what you want to achieve against three buckets: against your personal life, against your business, and also against your communal life. And the communal thing is important in community, because all the research out there says that people that give back are happier. Mm-hmm. And you write in these three buckets, looking back a year. So we would be doing it now going, well, it's March 2023, and I'm looking back on the year that was. And you set very specific goals for yourself. And people often don't do that in their personal life. We're often quite good in our business lives about doing it. But actually, you only get one life, so it's important to do all of it. So vision writing and hard work, kind of the two things go together. And then you'll look back on the year and you'll hopefully have achieved those goals.
We're definitely going to have a lot of people watching this that are aspiring entrepreneurs, that are women or have just started out with their companies. You know, what would be some kind of nuggets of advice you would give to somebody who might just be beginning this journey of, you know, their career or a career change or something of that nature?
Well, first off, I would say congratulations. I think there has never been a better time to set up a business, and there's never been more opportunities for women to be setting up in particular opportunities to create these new businesses out there. I think the internet has been a wonderful, all sort of acted like a democratization of everything that's gone before. So I would say you've already made the first part, and if you're thinking about it, just go for it. I was once told that the greatest risk was not to take the risk. Be bold, adopt a curiosity and a test of mind kind of way of thinking, test and learn, and not be afraid to fail. You know, one of the things that I've certainly learned from the world of tech is that you have to constantly fail. Otherwise, you're not going to be making the changes that you need to go forwards. And when you have those failures, then they will be there and they'll come. Take the learnings from them so that you don't make the same mistakes going forwards. But it's hard work, but the rewards will be there, and you'll look back on these early years of doing it, and you'll feel the success as a result. But you can do it. I'm excited for what people will do.
Awesome. That is all I have for you. So I appreciate you speaking with us.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Nicola. Thank you so much for tuning in to our interview with Nicola Mendelson. If you would like to hear more about International Women's Day, you can visit entrepreneur.com, and we'll have a whole hub of fun stuff and information there for you. So thanks so much for tuning in.
We hope you enjoyed our conversations with the women who inspire us. And check out entrepreneur.com for more coverage of compelling women entrepreneurs in honor of International Women's Day.